looked at enough fires for a while. That's what our last few videos have been about. Let's look at something different today, something, well, unique. Several things that are unique that we want to look at. And the first one is so unique, I believe it to be one of a kind. So unique that it was in Ripley's, believe it or not. Today, 3212 Stone Street is a part of an apartment complex. That's represented by this red rectangle. But at one time, there was a house here. This is the house that used to be at that location. Certainly a house that'll never appear in an architecture magazine. It was quite small and had a flat roof. So what was its claim to fame? Well, as we go a little higher, you might see. This house had a tree right in the middle of it. Some people called it a tree house. Actually, it's a house tree. I always called it the house with a tree in the middle. Occasionally, you'd even see someone trying to peek into the windows, trying to see the trunk of the tree inside. However, the tree can't be seen from the inside of the house. So why was the house built around the tree? To save the tree, says Esther Quinlan, sister of the builder. Quinlan said her brother, the late Russell Roseberry, lived in a house behind the great oak tree some 40 years ago. He wanted to build on the property in front, but he also wanted to keep the oak tree that stood there. Mr. Roseberry, being a carpenter and owner of a lumber yard, planned and built a small structure around three sides of the tree. The fourth was enclosed later. Early plans were to make it the Lone Oak Inn, but zoning problems complicated the matter. So Mr. Roseberry made it the Lone Oak Store. After the store, he used it as an office for his lumber business. When his health failed, he sold the lumber yard and remodeled the building into a house to rent. And it's been a house ever since. Renters who have lived there say the tree caused no problems other than limiting floor space and creating a circular room layout. The tenants never had trouble giving direction to the house. Just drive down Stone Street until you see a house with a tree in the middle. The photos you've been looking at is actually the demolition of that house. And of course, once the house was gone, the tree came next. 1980, a new owner took over by the name of Gary Stote. He said the small wooden frame building was in need of extensive repair and was expensive to maintain. It had no foundation and did not conform to building codes. The place had been vacant since the last resident died. The house was bug infested and roots from the tree were coming up through the floor. Stote said that the apartment complex on the adjoining lot will be extended onto the property. He wanted the parking area enclosed for new apartments, so the tree had to be removed. Stote said a neighbor had counted the rings in the tree after it fell and estimated the oak to be about 150 years old. Well, folks, we gained a larger apartment complex, but we lost the house with the tree in the middle. Something else that was unique to the area, just south of town in Smith Creek, was Little Dodge City. A bit of the Old West. Live-action shows, picnic area, rides, gunfights every weekend. 6270 Frith Road, Smith Creek. Well, it wasn't really on Frith Road. It set back off of Frith Road, as you can see from this map here. And of course, Mitchell Road is now called Wadhams Road. Little Dodge City was a place where the Old West could live again. It all started with a fellow by the name of Bill Jollett. Bill needed a hobby to take his mind off the 20th century with all its glories and woes. His hobby was a little unusual. It involved about 10 people originally and grew to be about 30 people who spent virtually every spare moment working on it. And like a lot of hobbies, Bill's hobby was contagious. You see, he's building a model, not a boat or an airplane, but an entire city. And the city is a chapter out of American history from another century. Dodge City's Bullhorn Saloon is not in Kansas. It's about 10 minutes from Marysville, Michigan. Dodge City was an unfinished dream that started to become a reality in 1961 when the Country Western Park first opened. On Sundays from Memorial Day to Labor Day, the clock has turned back to the 1800s in Dodge City, where the gunfight shows are our main attraction. Not only was Dodge City a tourist attraction, but it was also tourist accommodations because it was basically built to be a campground. And as we zoom in here, we can see real old West style camping for only $4 weekends and $3.50 weekdays. What a deal. And here we have the welcome letter to Dodge City Campground. I won't read all of it. I'll let you read it yourselves, but I'll take out part of this for you. It says, "Welcome, partner, to Dodge City Campground Incorporated. Mighty proud you folks come to visit Dodge City. Yup, real old West type camping and real good fishing, too. Live action gunfight shows on Main Street every weekend, starting Memorial Day weekend till September. Camping ain't camping without a campfire. Collect all the wood you need from our woods that is dead and down, or purchase ready cut from our general store. Please collect your wastewater in a bucket and empty it in our outhouses." This letter, as well as several pictures, was supplied to us by Cassie Burns Simkowski. Hopefully I'm pronouncing that correctly. If not, my apologies. Here's a photograph of the sheriff and his deputy with the jail in the background. And here's a little better picture of the sheriff. In this photograph here, it looks like there's been a little gunplay. Either that or the fellows were just tired of standing up. Well, there's more than just gunplay to Little Dodge City. They brought in some wonderful musical acts. You'd be walking down Main Street to the saloon and you'd hear something like this from inside.
Almost heaven, West Virginia, Blue Ridge Mountains, Shenandoah River. Life is old there, older than the trees, younger than the mountains, growing like a breeze. Country roads, take me home to the place I belong, West Virginia.
Or once you get through those saloon doors, you might see this lady on stage.
His country sweetheart, Hall of Famer, Miss Myrna Laurie.
I wish that I could fall in love today, but old memories of you stand in the way, and I just can't make my heart find someone new. It's always much too busy loving.
Well, the adults, they love the music. But the kids, they want to see the gunplay. I came across this whole movie that someone took of Little Dodge City and thought you might enjoy seeing some parts of it. You can't hear much in the way of audio, but it gives you an idea of what it was like.
Hey, think he's going to kill me?
Why are you in trouble, you fool?
Let's see that gun, Pancho.
What for?
I said let's see it.
He's trying to steal my woman.
Look, you're right off the
want to try and make a move?
Bob!
Hey. What are you doing?
I'm defending myself, Walmart.
My friend, man.
I don't care whose friend it is.
I'm here, but I'm here.
What if this is special?
Well, it looks like no one got out of Little Dodge City alive. What a shame. And in front of all those children. Whoops, I misspoke. Everyone got out alive. Not only that, they got to go on a hayride. What a way to end the day. So whatever happened to Little Dodge City? Like the old West, Little Dodge City did not survive the times. They had a change of owners, and all the volunteer help that the first owners had did not transfer to the new owners. You can't ask a fellow to fall off a two-story building onto the ground for free. Then they charge if you're not a volunteer, and they charge a lot. New owners were Irene and Douglas Burns, and they closed the business in 1981 after finding it too much of a financial burden. And now, Little Dodge City is no longer. What was left of the buildings have been torn down, but many of us still remember when it was our own little western town. Well, I thought we could get to another couple of unique things around Port Huron, but we'll get to them in our next video. So join me then.